Sorry about that. We're not perfect by any means. And piano isn't either, so. It's the devil fighting. This song that we're going to sing, it's called Redemption Draweth Nigh. Pastor's been preaching the last how many weeks about heaven? I want to be ready to go when he says, time's up. Redemption draweth nigh, and my Redeemer has prepared the way for me. He said, you've got to be ready, though. We don't know when the trumpet's going to sound, Pastor. We don't know when that's going to happen. But the key is, be ready when he says, time's up. Redemption draweth nigh.
Stand in the reading of God's word, and invite you to do that today. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. May God now receive a blessing from the reading and hearing of his word. You may be seated. It seems like today there is a controversy surrounding heaven and hell. We have many different opinions and writers out there who share with us their ideas of what heaven and hell is. But I praise God today that we don't take our information from what someone says. We don't take our information from what someone writes. No, we take our information straight from the pages of the Word of God, the infallible Word of God. And when we have this idea out there in society that the Christian world, we have made up heaven and hell. It is just some magical place that we have created in our minds in order for you and I to deal with the pain of life, the trials and the disappointments that come our way. However, as we have already discovered in the Word of God, the Bible clearly reveals to us that heaven is a real place. It is a real location. It is a place where real people, God's people, when they pass from this world, enter into his presence. Matter of fact, Jesus himself says this to his disciples over in John chapter 14, beginning in verse 1. Let not your hearts be troubled. You know, I can paraphrase here and say, Christians, why are we letting our hearts be troubled? You believe in God, believe also in Jesus. Jesus says, in my Father's house, speaking of heaven, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would not have told you. Jesus says, if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. We also discovered through our studies in the Bible that right now Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercession on our behalf. Matter of fact, the Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising shame and rejection, he has sat down at the right hand of the Father. Can you imagine Jesus right now sitting there in heaven as he is beginning to look over one of the greatest, biggest construction projects in all of the world? He's overseeing our future home, this place called heaven. Today, though, it seems like we're living in a society, maybe even in the circle of Christianity, where people want to ignore, people want to deny the reality of heaven and hell. And we know, do we not? We know many people who have their opinions on heaven and hell. Do you know, as I read the Bible, nowhere in there does it say that God asks for our opinion. Matter of fact, it doesn't even say that God cares about our opinion on heaven and hell. Because our eternal destination has already been set by God. It's either heaven or hell, and we choose what road we are going to travel. And we know, do we not? We know that heaven and hell, the reality of it, it's not based upon our human understanding, but it's based upon the Word of God. We believe in the Word of God to be the infallible Word of God. Amen. Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, all Scripture. He doesn't say some of it. He doesn't say parts of it. He doesn't say just the New Testament or the Old Testament. He says all Scripture is God-breathed. And it is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So we've been in the Word of God, and we've been looking at the idea of heaven and hell. So far, we have drawn two conclusions from God's Word. The first one is this: everyone has an eternal destination. Everyone in this place, everyone listening today through social media, everyone beyond the four walls of this church, all of us, we have an eternal destination. When our life ends, contrary to what some people say, our life will continue. When our life ends, you all, we're going to make a trip. We're going to go to a very unfamiliar place in some ways, but we're going to go to a place that the Bible has shared with us that we will know when we get there. And in this destination that you and I are going to take, you all, it's not like a one-week stay at a beach or at the mountains or somewhere else. No, it's our eternal destination. The Bible says it is our final resting place, either heaven or hell. Listen to me very carefully. We cannot get this wrong, because it is our eternal destination. It's not something the preacher's saying. It's not something that the Nazarene denomination made up. No, you all, it's right here in the pages of God's Word. And the Bible says, if you reject what Jesus did for you upon the cross, then your eternal destination is in a place called hell. But praise God, the Bible says if you're a Christian, if you've been born again, if you've given your heart and life to God through Jesus Christ, then our destination is to that place called heaven. However, you decide which course and destination you're going to take. I don't make that decision. This church doesn't make that decision for you. Your spouse or your family doesn't make that decision for you. That is a personal decision you have to make right now in your heart. The Bible says there's two roads. One is a narrow road and one is a wide road. The narrow road, there's few on it. That's the one that's going to heaven.
Yes. Amen.
The wide road where there's many on, that's going to an eternal hell. The choice rests upon our decision of what we're going to do with Jesus. But there is a second conclusion that we've drawn from the Bible about heaven and hell. The Bible says there's only one way to get there. I don't care what someone else says. I don't care what someone else writes. The Bible says, not the preacher, not the Nazarene church, the Bible says there's only one way to heaven. Jesus says, I am the way.
Amen.
He said, no one. I don't care what social class, racial class you may be, no one goes to heaven except by me. So let's begin to look at this today as we conclude from last week. We're looking at some facts about heaven. I pray that as we go over some of these facts, that you will become excited about heaven. I want to tell you, I can't even begin in my human mind to comprehend everything there is to know about heaven. But in my human inability, I want to share a couple things with you. Let's look at some details concerning heaven. First of all, let's look at the shape of the city. Revelation chapter 21, verse 16. The city is laid out as a square. Its length as great as it is in breadth. And he measured the city in degree. 12,000 furlongs in length, breadth, height are equal. And what John is saying here, that the new city, the new heaven, it's going to be 1,400 miles long. Think about that. It's going to be 1,400 miles high, and it's going to be 1,400 miles wide. And you may say, preacher, how did you get that? I didn't get that. John told us what it was right here in Revelations. If you're not good at math, then I'm sorry, but if you're good at math, you can figure that out. Also, listen to this. John tells us, in commentaries write to us, that heaven is so large that 40 billion people can be fit in to heaven. That's a lot of people. 40 billion. I pray that it's maxed out, don't you? I pray that everyone gets into that city, that place called heaven. Now, what's even more interesting than the shape of the city is the foundation. Listen to Revelation chapter 21, 19. The foundations of the walls of the city were adorned with all kinds of precious stones. Now, to me, this just amazes me. If you read the 21st chapter of Revelation, it tells us there's going to be 12 layers of stone. Now, I'm not a man, I'm not much into the diamonds and all the glittery stuff, but ladies, some of you, when you see those diamonds, you smile, right? Matter of fact, some ladies, if you don't get the diamonds at your anniversary, birthday, you're disappointed. Diamonds. It says it's the lady's best friend. But can you imagine when you get to heaven, 12 layers of gemstone there in the streets as we walk down that great city in heaven. Each layer inlaid in its own precious stone. And then the walls, listen to the walls. Revelation 21, 17. The city is laid out as a square. Its length is great and breadth. Its measure of the city, therefore, 1,000 and 1,000, as we read, as equal. John says the walls, and that is a misinterpretation, and he looked that verse back up. He says the walls are 216 feet high, made of jasper. Can you imagine walking around on them streets? Can you imagine looking at the glorious jasper walls as we stroll down the streets of heaven? And then in Revelation chapter 21, 21, we're told there's 12 gates. John says there's 12 gates in the city. Three of the gates on each side, representing the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, if that doesn't get you excited, let me talk about the atmosphere in heaven. What heaven is going to be like? Heaven will be a place where there will be no more death. We'll never gather at another funeral home. We'll never say goodbye to another loved one. There'll be no more death in heaven. There's going to be no more sorrow in heaven. There's going to be no more sickness in heaven. There'll never, ever again be a doctor come to you and say, I'm sorry, you have cancer or you have something else. There'll never be another sickness in that beautiful city. There's going to be no pain. There's going to be no hospitals. You'll never go to another hospital. Can I tell you something else, seniors? You can throw that handicap sticker away. You'll never need another one. You'll never hear what I hear. Your prescription is ready. Please pick it up. There'll never be another prescription to fill. There'll never be another doctor's appointment for you and us to meet. There'll never be another rest home for us to have to go in or visit. But most of all, there'll be no more sin, no more wickedness, no more violence. It's going to be a perfect atmosphere to be in. Listen, who would not want to go there? I don't understand that. When you can be ushered out of this old sinful sick world and go and be in that perfect environment. So first of all, we see the details of heaven, and we started on this last week, the activities that's going to take place in heaven. And I'm going to go back and repeat a couple we had and add on to it. First of all, as we talked last week, heaven's going to be a place of incredible worship. I hope you like singing. If you don't like to sing, you better learn how to sing. There's going to be a lot of singing in heaven. John says we're going to be lifting up our voices in praise and singing unto God. In Revelation 14:3, after these things, he said, I heard a loud voice, a great multitude in heaven saying, Hallelujah, salvation, glory, and honor, and all power belongs to the Lord our God. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what that atmosphere is going to be like? You know, we talked about this last week, of some of the great worship experiences that we've had. I know I've had mine, and I know some of you have had yours. And I go back and I remember those times where I saw the movement of God in such a way in which I've never seen before. In one of them worship services where you get the goosebumps and the hair stands up on your head. One of those times that you'll never forget in your life. It'll never leave your mind. Yet that doesn't even compare to the experience that we're going to have in heaven. You take that and multiply it by a million times. That's what your worship experience is going to be in heaven. First of all, we're going to be worshiping because we are going to be in the presence of Jesus. The one who paid it all. The one who laid down his life because He loved us. And when you get time today, go home and read Revelation chapter 5, beginning in verse 11. It kind of gives us a glimpse into heaven. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what heaven is going to be like? I don't know about you, but I can't wait to get there. I'm ready. God can call me out of this world anytime. John says we're going to be praising God with a loud voice. But second of all, he says in heaven we're going to be enjoying some enjoyable work. As we talked last week, I can already hear the groans right now. Really? We're going to have to work in heaven? I know, I didn't dream that. I'm like some of you. I really thought I was going to be floating around on this beautiful cloud. I really thought the angels were going to be washing my feet, putting a rag on my head, feeding me grapes, playing the harp as I floated by every day. And now all of a sudden you're telling me we're going to be working in heaven. Preacher, how in the world do you even draw that conclusion? Well, go back to Genesis. God was a worker. God created heaven in 6 days, and on the seventh day he rests. Can I tell you something contrary to what some people say? God never sat down for eternity. God's still working. Praise God, he's working in my life and he's working in your life. I'm glad God didn't take a permanent vacation. He's alive and active even to this very hour. God was a worker. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 15, and God took man to put him in the Garden of Eden. What for? To look at it? No. To work it and take care of it. Second of all, God created us to be workers. You were created to be a worker. Now I know as we look at our stats in our state, 40% of our people who are living on government assistance who are not working. Don't get me wrong, some of you need government assistance. Praise God for that. I'm glad you have it. I'm talking about the couch potatoes who lay on the couch who can't work, who don't want to work. 40% of West Virginians sitting at home not willing to work while the other 50-some percent work. God, he created us to be workers. You know, sometimes I think people think that work is a curse. Especially the time Friday rolls around and you're ready to get home. But you all work is not a curse, it's a blessing. It's a blessing from God that God gave us the ability, first of all, but second of all, that God gave us the job. God has provided for you and I to take care of our family. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 15, therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve Him day and night. I hear some groans already. Day and night. Serving God day and night. According to John in Revelation chapter 7 here, he says we're going to be serving God continuously, day and night. And maybe you're saying, well, preacher, how is that? Well, we're going to have the perfected body. In heaven, we're not going to get tired. In heaven, we're not going to get weary. In heaven, we're not going to need any sleep. Therefore, we're going to be able to work continuously, day and night. All right, so I turned you off on that. Let's go to the next one. It's going to be a place of great ruling as we talk. Some people are going to rule in heaven. It's in Revelation chapter 7, verse 15. It says we're going to be serving God. Ruling in heaven. Overseeing the heavenly affairs of God. You know, I'm finding some people have no problem being in charge. Some of you men can say amen, that's okay. But you know that was God's plan even from Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 1, 26. And then in Revelation chapter 22, verse 5, in the new heaven, in the new earth, John tells us that some people are going to be in charge in heaven. They're going to be ruling over the affairs of heaven. If you go to Luke chapter 19, beginning in verse 11, it tells us two things if you want to be a ruler in heaven. First of all, you have to have a desire to want to be in leadership. Leadership's a desire. You've got to have a desire. You've got to want to be a leader. I'm finding some people don't like to be a leader. That's okay. Not everyone's called to be a leader. But if you're called to be a leader, then God called you to lead. Second of all, you have to have the ability to rule. And that comes through faithfulness. One of the criteria of leadership is faithfulness. 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 I believe, church, this is one of the areas that we really need to secure up. If you're in leadership, you should be faithful. Not only to God, but you should be faithful to the church of the living God. Dr. Graham says, how you handle your time, your treasures, your opportunity that God has given you, it will determine your responsibility in heaven. A spiritual leader is one who serves others. Leaders are not called for people to serve them. We are called to serve people. That's one thing we stress on our board. Heaven. It's going to be a place of incredible worship. I can't wait. It's going to be a place of enjoyable work. You know, I was thinking about this enjoyable work, and I was kind of inflated when I first read it. And then I thought about some of you ladies and how you love your flower gardens, how much fun it is. That's what kind of work it's going to be like. Heaven's going to be a place of ruling, but heaven's going to be a place of awesome fellowship. The early Christians emphasized fellowship. They emphasize the importance of fellowship. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And they continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine, breaking of the bread and in prayer. Why is fellowship so important? Because it brings us together as one. One mind, one spirit, and one body under the lordship of Jesus Christ. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what fellowship is going to be like in heaven? Hey, if you think our ice cream socials are great, and you think our potluck dinners are great, and our time out the fire is great, you wait until we get to heaven. What an awesome time of fellowship it will be in heaven. But here's one thing I really like about heaven. It's going to be a place of great reunion. I can't wait to get to heaven. First of all, I want to see Jesus. But I want to see some of them awesome, faithful saints that I had to say goodbye to. I can't wait. Loved ones, friends, neighbors, that we knew so well, passed on from this world, and now is in eternity with God. One day, we're going to be reunited. What a time of fellowship. I know some of you right now, you're feeling the pain of a loss of a mother, a father, a sibling, a child, a close friend. One day, those who are Christians, the Bible says, we're going to be reunited with them there in heaven. And what a great time it will be to be with one another as we fellowship together with Jesus. In closing, heaven's going to be a place of incredible learning. We're going to learn when we get to heaven. Can I share with you three things we're going to learn when we get to heaven? First of all, we're going to learn about God. You know, we hear a lot about God, do we not? We talk a lot about God, but when we get to heaven, we're going to learn about our God. And here's one thing that we're going to learn, one thing we preach, one thing we teach, one thing we believe: there is only one God. Amen. And when we get to heaven, we're going to find out there's only one God in heaven. God. We're going to find out that everything that was said about God is true. He's a God of love. He's a God of mercy. He's a God of compassion. He's a God of grace. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But He's also a God of judgment, a God of correction and discipline, just like parents correct their children. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. The Bible says, "For there is one God, one mediator, between man and man, between God and man, the man Jesus Christ, who gave a ransom for it all, to be testified in due time." And then in James chapter 2, verse 19, "You believe there is one God? You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble." We're going to learn about God. Second of all, we're going to learn about God's plan. How many times have you heard this? How many times have you said this? Why? Why? I don't think anybody in here has an answer to the question of why. I don't know why. I don't know why a loving, kind, gracious God allows things to happen in life. But I believe when we get into heaven, we're going to understand why. Because I believe God's going to unveil His plan and purpose that He had for our lives. And can I tell you today, no one goes through anything by accident. It's all by the divine plan of God. There is no such word as accident. It's all by the providence of God. And I can't wait to get to heaven and see how God was unveiling His plan in my life and in your life. And the areas that I didn't understand and the areas that you didn't understand what God was doing. But I like this. We're going to learn about the power of God. Have you ever just grasped hold of how powerful God is? He spoke in Genesis 1:1, and the creation happened. It doesn't say anything that He took His hands out there and took a hammer and a saw, and He began to, or a magic wand. He says He just spoke it into existence. In Psalms chapter 19, verse 1, it says, "Heaven, it declares the glory of God, and the firmament shows in His handiwork." Can I share with you two things the psalmist shares with us about the power of God? First of all, we find here that He is a God of splendor. He's a God of splendor. Heaven declares the glory of God. You know, it's amazing to me how people can go out on a clear night and look up at the moon and the stars. How people can not see the power of God in it. How we can drive by those great, beautiful mountains. How we can look out at the oceans and the seas. How we can look up now and just from our very eyes and see nature popping through the ground with their beautiful blooms on them and the trees that are blooming. How can we deny there is a God? Because God's handiwork is all around us every day of our lives. But also, He is a God of glory. He's a God of glory. The psalmist says, "Declare the glory of God." You know, I know and you know people who continuously reject Jesus. Some of you have been trying to share your faith for a long time and people just reject you. But I want to tell you something. The Bible says one day, every tongue will bow before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and they will confess Him as Lord. Wouldn't you rather go ahead and do it now than wait to do it then and be sent off to an eternal place you don't want to go?
Yes.
Heaven. Hell. The Bible tells us it's a reality. It's a real place. The Bible says every one of us, we have a destination. We're traveling one of two roads. We're traveling either the road that leads to hell or the road that leads to heaven. The Bible says we individually make that choice. Every one of us, sooner or later, we're walking down the halls of death. No one wants to talk about it. I don't like to talk about it, but it's a reality in all of our lives. One day, we're all walking down that hallway. And at the end of the hallway will be your destination, either heaven or hell. God places that choice into your hands. It's called a free will. But let me ask you, if you was to go out here today and your life was to end, do you know? Do you know without a shadow of a doubt that you'll go to heaven? If not, the Bible says today is the day the Lord has made. Today's the day of salvation. Today's the day to get things right with God. You're not here by accident, remember? You're here by the divine plan of God. God knew that you'd be here today. God knew that you would listen to this. God holds you accountable today for what you have heard. And maybe you're here today and you say, Richard, I just don't know if I'm on the right road. It's okay. There comes times in people's life where people might not know if they're on the right road. Praise God, I know I'm on the right road. Some of you know you're on the right road. But I want to tell you today, if you don't know, you can be on the right road. Maybe you're here and you know that if you die that you're not going to go to heaven. And you're saying, Richard, I want to get on the right road. Let me share with you how to get on the right road. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. Pray this with me today. Dear God, I'm on the wrong road. I want to get on the right road. I come to you in the name of Jesus. I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I'm sorry for my sins. And the life I have lived was outside of your will. I need your forgiveness. I today believe in your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. I believe he shed his blood for me on the cross and died for my sins. I am willing right now, God, to turn from my sins. You said in the Bible that if I confess the Lord God and believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead, I shall be saved. God, I make that confession today. I choose to be on the right road. I believe in you. I ask you into my heart as Lord and Savior. I'm going to ask everyone to stand. Every head is still bowed. Every eye is closed. If you prayed that today, we're going to ask you to come. Maybe today you're just not sure. We're going to ask you to come. Maybe today you're not 100% where God wants you to be, and you do not want to get into His presence, not being where He wants you in your life. And I'm going to invite you to come. Whatever it may be, you come this morning and shield the place. Every head will stay bowed, every eye is closed. If you need to come today, don't delay. You step out.